following program on Other Derana 24 is classified for general audience. It is intended for all ages. It contains little or no violence, no strong language, and little or no sexual dialogue or situations. The following program contains opinions of the participants and does not reflect the views and beliefs of the Derana Media Network. The network believes in a safe space for all ideas to be expressed and on its duty to create such a platform for free speech. Viewer discretion is strictly advised. From Studio 24 in Colombo, for a real view, real opinion, and for an honest conversation, it's time to get real with Mahieash Johnney.
A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Get Real, where we talk to notable newsmakers here at home and abroad and try to give you a different perspective. Our aim here is to not go with the mainstream narrative, but ask certain questions that would get you a different type of an answer that'll make you to make your own judgment about issues pertaining to our country and our nation's growth. Right now, today's focus is going to be about foreign affairs and exactly what we are doing with the world and how that is impacting the economic recovery and per se. To talk about, are we heading with a plan at hand or is it just ad hoc work from the get-go? In order to discuss that, I've invited the State Minister of Foreign Affairs, Tharaka Balasuriya. Welcome back to the program. Good to see you, sir. So let's start with there's this key question that is roaming around, Minister. That is to you come from the Sri Lanka Podu Jana Peramuna. That's how you contested the 2020 election, and that's so you were elected by the Podu Peramuna, and then you had a leader, former President Gotabaya Rajapaksa. Now we have seen
leader was Mahinda Rajapaksa.
The president. Yeah. And then now we see there's a new president from a different party, which were in clash with each other in terms of how to govern the country. The United National Party had a different ethos, the Sri Lanka Podu Jana Peramuna or the SLFP or the UPFA, they had a different ethos. Now we see all of them coming together in order to address this crisis and moving on. So what is the core element of our foreign policy in terms of right now? We went through an economic crisis. Is this a mix of everything, or what are we striving to do right now?
Well, I think the foreign policy itself has not changed. Okay, since 1950s, we have had an unaligned foreign policy or neutral foreign policy. And then when I talk to some of my colleagues in SJB, they also say that they will follow an unaligned foreign policy. And recently I was in a TV debate, Rupwani TV debate, and then one gentleman, Professor Anil Fernando, I believe from the NPP, also participated. What he stated was that the NPP also will follow a non-aligned foreign policy. So I think any political party in Sri Lanka will follow a non-aligned foreign policy with giving due consideration to India's security. That's the same thing which the NPP said. So I don't think, whatever the party comes to power, the foreign policy itself will change.
Now, what exactly is the focus of the foreign ministry right now? Because basically linking up with these countries who are going to help us economically is quite crucial, and those kinds of bilateral agreements, free trade agreements that are currently being worked out, those actually goes through your. So what is the focus right now in terms of, let's say, a free trade agreement? Are you actually just opening our markets and let everybody have a gung-ho here, or how what's the focus?
Well, it doesn't actually go through us, it goes through the Commerce Department. I think there's a plan by the President in the future to amalgamate the Commerce Department and the Foreign Ministry. When Gotabaya Rajapaksa, the former President, he started off, initially it was the Commerce Department was under the Foreign Ministry. I think that's your interpretation of FTAs is the general view in Sri Lanka. Okay, the people tend to think that trade is bad. People tend to think that, you know, if you open up, if you have a free trade agreement, it will harm Sri Lanka. If people also tend to think that it's a zero-sum game, that if one country gains, the other country must lose. So the trade internationally doesn't work like
that. So how do you do that? How do you make sure that Sri Lanka wins, plus whoever is coming for business to do business here also wins?
Well, for starters, the trade works on comparative advantage, not absolute advantage. Now, say, you know, you are the world's best presenter, for example, and then let's say you also want to whitewash your house. Okay. So then if you spend certain amount of time not doing what you are good at, but if you instead then you go and whitewash your house, although you might have an absolute advantage over, since you're relatively young, or you have absolute advantage in terms of efficiency over older gentleman who whitewashes houses or something, it would be more productive for you to do your job and then get somebody else to whitewash the house. Okay, so simple as that. So that's
the question I'm asking. Why I'm asking is that is the theory that has worked since the 70s onwards, where we say let's get somebody who knows a better way of doing it,
yeah,
and we bring them. So that kind of has eroded the whole industrialization of Sri Lanka and basically pushed us towards import oriented economy, where we try to bring everything from outside, trying India, lots of products. Mm-hmm. So, isn't it the same thing that you're saying?
No. I think that's you're misinformed in that regard. Let's say, for example, the Sri Lanka India FTA.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, if you look at when the FTA was first signed, India used about 20% of the 20% of the goods which came to Sri Lanka was through the FTA. Sri Lanka used at that time about 90%, 80% of the goods which Sri Lanka exports to India was through the FTA. Now Sri Lanka exports about 70% of Sri Lanka's exports to India are through the FTA, but India's percentage of goods which India exports to Sri Lanka still remains around 10%. So most of the goods which come to Sri Lanka, Indian goods which come to Sri Lanka, are not through the FTA. They're general products. They're in the negative list of example things such as vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now if you look at the vehicle manufacturing in India, when the Marutis were initially quite basic cars, but the third generation, the fourth generation of Marutis are somewhat much better, and they are in line with let's say other international car mm-hmm. makers. Okay? So people tend to assume that because the trade deficit widens, that's because of the FTA, but then we haven't signed an FTA with China.
No, but you have to.
Let me finish. No, we haven't signed an FTA with China. Okay, in 1995, I think the trade between China and Sri Lanka, China's exports to Sri Lanka was about 150 million. Now it's about 5.5 billion. Okay, so the trade deficit
rupees
between
dollars.
Okay, the trade deficit between China and India, China and Sri Lanka has also widened. So you can't really blame the FTA on
that. It's not that, Minister. That's what we are trying to understand. Now, we went through an economic crisis.
Yeah.
And that economic crisis was purely because, not purely, but this particular fact contributed to it largely, the import-oriented mentality of our people, and basically sending the dollars we earn towards, you know, whatever the country. Now, you said China's trade gap widened. So did India's. Now, that continually happens. That particular hole that we've created in our economy, you know, where we were told, you know, we got to keep the dollars here. I'm not saying that we should be anti trading or anything of that nature, but what I'm trying to understand here
you
is...
You sound very anti...
No, it may sound, but what... So that's why I want you to explain to us, because this is what our mentality is. This is what people outside think.
Yeah.
Now, tell us how what y'all are doing right now is different from that, and how we are going to get to the point where we should as a nation, and that we will not face a crisis the way we are facing right
now. I think the crisis started off as a foreign exchange crisis, okay, and that's there are different symptoms for that, including, you know, the COVID and our mismanagement of the economy, particularly the fertilizer issues, things such as that. But we cannot go into work in isolation. We need to really integrate with the supply chain of the world. And in order to integrate with the supply chains of the world, we need to go to FTAs. But the FTAs alone is not going to be sufficient to increase trade. Just because you sign an FTA, it doesn't mean you're going to increase trade. But also, now India, for example, if you look at the India's and Sri Lanka's the trade between the two countries, India was biggest import of Sri Lanka had been India even before the FTA.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then if you look at the products which Sri Lanka had imported to exported to India before the FTA, it was mainly things such as the spices and tea and things such as that. But after the FTA, the product range is much wider. Okay, so it has actually helped the Sri Lankan exporters in trying to penetrate the Indian market. But why the trade deficit between Sri Lanka and India has widened is it's for different reasons, because India is industrializing fast, and then they are specializing in certain things such as pharmaceuticals, such as vehicle manufacturing and things like that. And those things are outside of the FTA, but they still come reach Sri Lanka. And because they are price competitive, even without the FTA, that's why the trade deficit between Sri Lanka and India has widened.
So what is the path forward right now? What are y'all working on? That obviously what y'all are working on, we know this is an election year, we know it could be a new government, the same government, whatever, but there should be certain clauses that is being put into whatever y'all are doing right now that will last for at least 5, 10, whatever the time, because consistency is one of the issues that we've been having in our governing system.
Yeah.
So what exactly are y'all putting right now that will help Sri Lanka, let's say 3 years down the line, 5 years down the line, basically to come out and be a strong competitor in the world market through these kinds of negotiations?
So one part of it is the FTA. So we will be signing FTA, we are negotiating with China, then there I think in March we will be signing FTA with PTA with Indonesia.
The Thailand one?
Thailand one was already signed the third of February. So we really want to integrate with the supply chains of the world, and we want to be a member of the RCEP. We have sent a letter of intent to RCEP. There are 15 countries in the RCEP, and we want to trade. And if we really integrate into the supply chains of the world, we feel that, you know, there's a lot of room for development in that regard, and also it makes our businesses in Sri Lanka far more competitive. You know, we can't have a protectionist, or we can't have an infant industry argument forever. Even countries, let's say even countries such as, you know, US and UK and Korea, for example, who have used protectionist policies, they have used protectionist policies to a certain period of time. If, for example, if you look at, I think, Hyundai, when they first manufactured the vehicle called Pony, okay, or Indian, if you look at the Marutis, okay, it was Suzuki Maruti, I believe.
It was Suzuki Maruti. Became later on.
Yeah,
but it was initially, I think, it was Maruti.
You know, when they manufactured these the Jeeps and all they used collaborations with some international company. And then thereafter, after a certain period of time, they said, well, you know, you need to, well, at least in the Hyundai's case, they said, no, you need to develop your own engines. Okay, so thus developed the motor industry in South Korea. Until 1988, I believe, South Korea banned the exportation of vehicles. Okay, and then they banned exportation of vehicles from Japan. Importation of vehicles to Korea. And I think until 1998, they banned the importation of vehicles from Japan.
Yeah.
Okay. But then they liberalized it. So
we at that point?
Well, you have to start somewhere, but we can't be, for 75 years we've been following, you know, protectionist policies, and it has not got us anywhere.
In terms of, I want to ask about the president's visit to various nations. He goes, there have been a lot of visits by the president to various other countries, various summits, various corporations that he has been there much more than any other president, I would say.
Yeah.
What has that actually garnered back to Sri Lanka? Because what we see is good speeches made by the president in those particular forums.
Yeah.
But what have we got after he does all that?
Well, when a president goes overseas, a lot of doors open for the others who follow. And then at the highest level, you can put a framework, and that framework had to be followed, we have to follow the framework which has been deliberated at the highest level through the foreign ministry and the other line ministries. So some of the president's visits, I think, which are not highlighted, these also their business delegations comes. So those business delegations get the opportunity to meet other people in business in those countries. And also the president's visits are mainly multilateral events. So when you go for a multilateral event, you meet other world leaders. Okay, now I know there was a lot of in social media and all that, the JFPs were attacking the president for visiting, I think, you know, the Queen's the funeral and all that, or the King's
coronation.
But you need to understand that, you know, all the other world leaders, especially the world leaders of the Commonwealth, also attends that function. Okay, so that gives an opportunity for president to meet all these.
That's what we are trying to understand. What are the opportunities we've actually got? I mean, it's good PR. It's good optics.
No. It's not PR. I mean, the president doesn't go there and then talk about, you know, how was the game last night. The president goes.
But it looks like that.
No, that's because that's
what I'm trying to ask
That might look like it for you, because you might not, certainly because you are not involved in that. Okay,
that's exactly why I'm asking from a person who is.
Yes, so then certainly before the president goes, the foreign ministry engages with that particular ministry in order to get a time, and then there are certain points, and including which the president will discuss with that particular the state leader, and thereafter, if they agree upon the points which have been discussed, let's say it could be renewable energy or whatever, then it's passed down to the line ministry to take it forward.
Okay? Is that happening?
Yeah, of course. Of course.
Lots more to discuss with the State Minister of Foreign Affairs, Tharaka Balasuriya. We've been talking about where the foreign policy per se is heading in our country right now after economic crisis, because there's a lot of work that the foreign ministry needs to do in order to link us with the world and benefit Sri Lanka on that particular path as well. Let's take a short commercial break. You're watching the video. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to Get Real. I'm in conversation with the State Minister of Foreign Affairs, Tharaka Balasuriya. We've been talking about Sri Lanka's foreign policy, the economic policy based on foreign diplomacy, basically talking to a lot of countries in order to get them to do business with Sri Lanka. Minister, I want to move on to the other aspects of basically you are a key minister of the Sri Lanka Podujana Peramuna. Right now we are talking about elections. 2024 is supposed to be an election year. We keep hearing this accusation by opposition parties that apparently there's never going to be a presidential election this year because of the simple fact that the current leader of the government, President Ranil Wickremesinghe, will never have the ability to face one, and he will use whatever the loophole in order to delay this election. Your leader, former President Mahinda Rajapaksa, is a fan of elections. I think he's the only leader who kept elections way before he was supposed to. So what exactly, are we to expect a presidential election this year or not?
Yes, certainly. I think we are to expect a presidential election this year. Whether the Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe, I don't know. I don't think he's a Democrat. I think and I believe that he's a Democrat, and he has not been backed by SPP. Okay, so he might not have been successful in the presidential elections, but now he's backed by SPP.
Why? What is the reason that you all want to back this candidate that you all spoke so aggressively against prior?
Because given the circumstances, that we thought that he was the best person to put the country through, and given the the time frame of what he has done, I think it's a remarkable job which he has done. People are forgetting the situation how it was maybe 1.5 years ago. We had long petrol queues. We didn't have enough medicine. We didn't have gas. But now things, if you look at Colombo, things are pretty much normal. Of course, we understand the cost of living is high. Okay, the people are suffering, and we need to make sure that once the cost of living increases, we know that it's not going to come down. So we need to make sure that the income levels of people increase. So if you look at now, the tourism industry is doing very well. The remittances are coming back. Investors are quite confident in Sri Lanka. I just saw a clip with Donald Liu, the U.S. Assistant Secretary of State, talking about Sri Lanka's case. I've seen Minister Jayashankar talking about Sri Lanka's case. Earlier, it was the case, Mahesh, that when I went overseas, people would say, how are your people doing? Do they have food to eat? Do they have the medicine? How's the situation in Sri Lanka? Even after some time, that when things were back to normal, people would always question in that line. But now, when I go overseas, people are asking, what's the secret of, turning this back so quickly. So I think he has shown tremendous leadership, and there has also been compromise. Let's take a look at our foreign policy, for example. Okay, we know during the Yapal period, they brought 30/1. When the Prime Minister was the Minister of Foreign Affairs, he said that we want to move away from co-sponsoring any thing against Sri Lanka. But the president is taking the same line. The president has not changed.
That's a good point you touched upon. 30/1, UNHRC session is going to start, I think, somewhere around in March again. And we know we're going to get hammered. And there has been so much of effort by these organizations who has been poking their finger into internal affairs, and no one have been able to ask them to please back back off. Now, if you look at what's happening in Ukraine, if you look at what's happening in the Gaza Strip, all these organizations are telling them, and nobody cares about what they say. Why haven't we been in a stronger position to basically tell them, these are our internal affairs, please stay away? And you said the president of the Yahapa, not the president, the prime minister of the Yahapa was the one who supported the 30/1, and now he's backed by the SLPP. Has he changed his views, or has he managed to change your views? How has that been?
No, it doesn't matter whether he has changed his views or not. What matters is the country's position. So the stand which the minister Gunawardena, now current prime minister, took, saying that we are not going to co-sponsor anything against Sri Lanka, has not changed. So I don't think, you know, I'm not, I don't know the president's personal view, and
no,
my personal view,
doesn't matter.
It's irrelevant.
No, that's what I'm asking.
What's relevant
this
is the
time, would it change?
No, it won't change. We will not be sponsoring any resolution against Sri Lanka.
In terms of other countries poking their finger into Sri Lankan affairs, something that your government, the previous government, was very vehemently against, and there have been so much of steps taken against it. Right now we see that it's
really
a free market.
No, Mahesh, didn't your mother teach you that life is not fair? In international politics also, it's not politics of morality which takes place. It's always power politics which takes place. Okay, so now we have to understand sometimes. Although everybody likes to talk about rules based order, okay, but do people discuss whose rules it is? If you look at the UN system, how does the UN system work? It's a winners club. You know, the five countries.
Why are we entertaining it then?
So what do you suppose we need to do? We need to be like, you know, North Korea and say, you know, forget about all this, we'll move into isolation.
But we don't have to be North Korea, but we can actually take a stronger position than what
like
we are.
What country?
Whoever is against our country.
No, so that's why we have these international fora, and that we say that the UN system has to change. The financial architecture of the world has to change. And we also systems such as the political architecture of the world has to change. Now, let me give you a very, very brief example. For example, if you look at the United Kingdom, or Great Britain, at the time of the end of the war, I believe that I could be wrong, but if my memory serves me right, they controlled about 10% of the world's GDP.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And through the empire, they had with India's population, they had a very large percentage. But now they don't control 10% of the world's GDP.
Yeah.
They control maybe, I don't know, 1%, 3% of the world's GDP. And if you look at their population, also it's not a big country. So, but the five countries with the veto powers, it's pretty much all boys club who won the Second World War. But soon these things are changing. You know, if you look at countries like India, are moving up. Okay, but it doesn't mean that, you know, it's possible for India to change the world order by itself. Certainly, we will support any country which we feel that, you know, the political architecture and the financial architecture of the world needs to change.
In terms of dealing with the UNHRC, what exactly is the strategy this time around. I understand y'all will say definitely no, but we will see certain resolutions will come up, and they will say they will even be fluid enough to go into the 2022 crisis, which has nothing to do with the UNHRC. So in a situation like that, what exactly is the delegation this time hoping to do?
No, it's not a quite Simple as that. It's not a yes or no. It's like a multiple choice thing. It's you know, the resolution has certain certain, let's say, the accusations, and we will, you know, if there are any accusations, we will certainly counter that. But we also need to change ourselves, and you know
how.
Oh yeah, let's talk about corruption. Let's talk about, like, you know, the IMF diagnostic on the result, the report on governance. Okay, so we know that there's an issue with corruption. So we need to bring laws in order to counter corruption, and that's why the government brought the Anti-Corruption Act. Okay, so similarly, let's talk about good governance. Okay, the when the president came into power, he appointed the independent commissions in order to ensure that the power is not concentrated in one point. Yeah. So and now, if I'm referring to the ethnic issue. President has been very openly saying that, you know, in order to overcome the ethnic issue, we need to have some form of power devolution. Okay, so I think we the time has come to sit together with the minorities, the Tamil parties, and to ensure that, you know, there is some form of devolution that which they are reasonably pleased with.
Indeed. Let's take a short commercial break. More to discuss with the State Minister of Foreign Affairs, Tharaka Balasuriya. We've been talking about the current issues pertaining to the nation's process, especially outside of Sri Lanka, how we have to deal with certain organizations, certain forums, and how Sri Lanka needs to manage its sovereignty per se. You're watching Get Real. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to Get Real. I'm in conversation with the State Minister of Foreign Affairs, Tharaka Balasuriya. A lot we've discussed. This session has a very limited amount of time. Minister, I want to ask about this accusation that was there prior to the 2022 crisis, where a lot of finger-pointing occurred towards the foreign ministry, stating that our ambassadors, per se, our high commissioners, our ambassadors were out there, were supposed to be rallying the word about Sri Lanka and getting the support that it needs within the world, was not doing their job. Basically, they were having a good time, or, you know, they're going to have a kind of a vacation, per se, was the accusation that was made, and they were not actually bringing in lots of businesses or lots of opportunities back into this country. Now, has that changed?
I don't think there was anything to change in that. I think we have some of the very good diplomats in the foreign service. Of course, as in any organization, there are some one or two bad apples also. I'll be very open about that. And even if you look at the political appointments, I think the political appointments are very good. And also, even with amongst the political appointments, sometimes, you know, if you put a singer or somebody from outside or less known person, then what gets highlighted is that the person's CV. The fact that we were able to come out of this situation quite quickly is also a testament to the work our ambassadors has done. For example, when you look at these debt restructuring process, mm-hmm. we needed to get letters from certain countries, and then our in certain countries they didn't even consult the finance ministry. For example, Iran, the Iranian foreign ministry is arriving today. Their foreign ministry issued a letter without consulting the finance ministry. They are agreeable for the Sri Lanka's the debt restructuring. Okay, so I'm just giving you one example, but also with the other countries, we were able to do it in a record time. And but sometimes what happens is ours is a facilitating ministry, and what they do is not highlighted. Now we are having a program in Rupawahini called Connect Sri Lanka, which basically gives an opportunity for the foreign ministry, the ambassadors in the foreign ministry and the high commissioners to showcase what they are doing and what business opportunities are there in those countries. And sometimes the work which they do cannot be highlighted. Let's say it can be secretive in mm-hmm. nature. So we need to bear those things in mind. But I'm very proud of my officers in the Foreign Service, and I believe that they're doing a remarkable job.
We are not. We don't have the luxury to limit our relations to a certain sect of the world.
No, we don't.
So why are we not looking at Africa? Why are we not looking at South America? Why aren't we actually looking into those countries? And because if you take Africa, I think it's only at Nairobi we have a station, but the rest of South Africa, I think we have
Egypt.
So so in all those areas, but that's a vast market. That's an untouched potential opportunities for Sri Lanka. On the other side, South America, we do a lot of business with America, but not with South America. So what I mean, are we thinking in that direction?
Of course. I think even the president's visit to Uganda and showcased and look Africa policy and showcased that we are very serious about Africa. Some of the Sri Lankan companies which have gone to Africa is doing really well. We have 5 embassies in Africa, Egypt, South Africa, Ethiopia and Kenya and also Seychelles. But we are planning to open 2 more embassies in Rwanda and in Nigeria. Africa is growing at a tremendous pace, and it's right time that some of our industrialists go and visit Africa.
Is that advocation occurring? Because yes, the market is there, but are we going and telling our businesses, hey, look
of
at
course,
this? Of course,
we have arranged, particularly people from our construction industry, industries to visit Africa, people in for example, power generation, let's say hydro area, they are very active in Africa. And one of the ambassadors, I must say that Kalanathan is one of the best ambassadors we have in Africa. You tell him to pull a rabbit out of the hat, and he will pull a rabbit out of the hat. So I'm very, happy with the attention which we are putting to Africa. But of course, the Latin America, given the distance and the expenses and all that, we are looking mainly at political diplomacy. So with countries such as Cuba, Bolivia and all of them, we have very good political relations with those countries.
Why not trade?
Well, trade, we are trying it.
Because we already do it with North America. Why not South America?
Well, it's North America and South America is a completely different ballpark. We don't have too many missions in we have one in Cuba and we have one in Rio, in Brasilia. So we don't have too many missions. We are trying. We had a meeting with the honorary consulars and to see how we can concentrate on trade with the Latin American countries. One of the initiatives which we took was to try and promote our Ayurveda products in those countries, because pretty much the vegetation is quite similar. So what grows in Sri Lanka can be grown in those countries also. But the issue is the time and the travel to Latin America. It's very costly, we feel that the opportunity is more in Africa and also in Southeast Asia.
In terms of regional security, especially maritime security, I know you have been sitting in many forums to discuss that particular fact. In a situation like that, what is India leading, the rest following kind of an approach, or what exactly is the maritime? Because there is a lot of resources there as well, where we can capitalize on, we can look into, but a lot of countries, even when a ship from China comes into this country, there are lots of, you know, dodgy feelings in up there in India. So maritime security per se, what exactly is Sri Lanka's position, and what are we trying to...
No, I think it's not a question of India leading. I mean, if you look at the positions that the South Asia countries have taken on a lot of issues, it tends to be similar. If you look at the positions that India and Pakistan has taken on, let's say, you know, the certain issues such as the issues in issue with Palestine and all that, it has been very similar. Okay, so certainly I don't think you will make that accusation to Pakistan saying that India is leading. Okay. But we believe in the freedom of navigation, and we believe that that will help international trade. And we also realize that, you know, India is growing in stature. India is soon going to be the third largest economy in the world. And it's very important that India is assured in terms of its security needs. We will not certainly make Sri Lanka available for any other country to use it against India.
And that statement I've, like, multiple times, a lot of foreign ministers who sat in the same chair told me, and I accept that. One thing that one of the questions before we wrap up, Minister, is the fact that y'all are doing a lot of work outside in order to bring businesses into this country. But the mindset of our Sri Lankan in terms of, you know, opening their businesses and allowing investors to come in, take control, that still has not changed to a certain extent, despite the economic crisis we've done. So what exactly are you doing in order to address that particular thing here in Sri Lanka, rather than, you know, you can bring businesses, but once they come into our doorstep and our door is not open, then it's a bad image for Sri Lanka.
That's why we need people like you to tell the truth, okay, and change your mindset. So would you rather have a protectionist policy, and then would you rather, you know, you pay, let's say, you know, 300% more for tiles or something, or you get something from overseas, and then you can, and all the consumers benefit from that. And I think that, you know, the mindset to a certain degree has been also created by professionals. Certainly, if you look at the doctors, are completely opposed to any doctor coming. Even if you have a medical degree, or if you're qualified from Harvard, okay, you need to get registered in Sri Lanka, and that's a process on its own. Okay, and then any one of the top universities in the world, it makes it impossible for you to come and work in Sri Lanka. So is that the mindset you want to have? You know, the doctors now we know are living overseas, and they're completely entitled to do that. You know, if my family, if I can't support my family, and then, you know, if I can get a better salary overseas, you know, if I'm in that position, I might take that situation. But then you also have to be fair by the country. You see that, you know, every day in the news reports that there are so many doctors leaving, and this hospital doesn't have those doctors. Okay, but then with this, now doctors who have studied overseas in other countries, spending their own money, and then I think there are about 3,000 of those doctors who have studied in Russia and the other countries, but they can't practice in Sri Lanka, if not for that act, the 16 or the exam. Okay, so we need to think from the people's perspective. Okay, and so a lot of these professional services now, either way, with or without FTAs, you can do them. Let's take, for example, architectural designs. So you go around Colombo and see all these big buildings. Have they been designed by the local architects, or have they been designed by architects from Singapore? Okay, so even with or without FTAs, you can do that. So I think, you know, we need to be fair by the people, and we need to move away from this protectionist mindset, and we need to open up the country.
Indeed, lots of things that was discussed. And thank you very much, Minister, for coming in and sharing your ideas. State Minister of Foreign Affairs, Tharaka Balasuriya, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
All right, well, that's all the time we have for you tonight. Thank you very much for watching. I'll be back at around 9 p.m. on First and 9. See you then. Bye for now. Ich lieb nur dich allein.
Quiero que me expliques, por favor, lo que encierra la palabra amor. So, que no, no, nula da, desideraré ancor, porque per me tu sei la sola donna al mundo. Y love, wase caino co, toba. Love, wa futarino takara. Aishi aiba, ashitamo akarui. Love, love you, love, I love you. Love, love you, love, I love you. Love, love you, love.